You can never have too much makeup.
Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English. Coming up on today's program, Brian Lynn reports on Ukraine's new gains against Russian troops. Dorothy Gundy and Katie Weaver explain how to collect and save vegetable seeds for next year. Finally, we present the next part in our American history series, The Making of a Nation. But first, here is Brian Lynn.
Ukraine claimed Monday it had retaken several more villages from Russian troops as part of an ongoing counteroffensive in eastern Ukraine. The counteroffensive forced Russia to withdraw troops from several areas in recent days. News agencies reported that thousands of Russian forces had withdrawn from areas around the northeastern cities of Kharkiv and Izium. Russian soldiers reportedly left behind ammunition and equipment as they fled Izium, which Russia had used as a major military storage base. Oleh Sinyahubov is the governor of the Kharkiv area. He said, "In some areas of the front, our defenders reached the state border with the Russian Federation." Over the weekend, Russia's defense ministry said it was moving troops from that area to reorganize in the eastern area of Donetsk. Ukraine's chief commander, General Valery Salyusny, said Ukrainian forces had regained control of more than 3,000 square kilometers since the start of September. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky has described the latest offensive as a major success in the country's six-month-old war with Russia. Russian troops invaded Ukraine in February. Zelensky said late Sunday that Russian attacks had caused a total power outage in Kharkiv and Donetsk and partial blackouts in surrounding areas. Dnipropetrovsk governor Valentin Reznichenko wrote on the social media service Telegram that the Russians were unable to reconcile themselves to defeats on the battlefield. Ukraine's attacks in the Kharkiv area seemed to surprise Russia, which had moved many of its troops from that area to the south. Ukraine had publicly announced a counteroffensive there. The Russian troop withdrawals led to critical comments online from some Russian military experts and patriotic broadcasters. They described the situation as a major defeat for Russia's military campaign and urged Russian officials to strengthen the country's war efforts. The experts also criticized officials for celebrating a Moscow city holiday on Saturday that included fireworks and other public activities. In Kharkiv, officials praised a partial return to normal conditions. They noted that power and water operations were again working for about 80% of the area's population. Russian attacks on basic infrastructure have caused power outages in many areas across Ukraine. You are heroes, Kharkiv Mayor Ihor Terekhov wrote on Telegram about the return of power in Ukraine's second largest city. Thanks to everyone who did everything possible on this most difficult night for Kharkiv, to normalize the life of the city as soon as possible, Terekhov said. I'm Brian Lynn.
Many of the vegetables we grow in our gardens produce seeds, which can grow into plants if harvested and stored correctly. Late summer is the perfect time to start collecting them, reports Associated Press gardening expert Jessica Damiano. She warns up front about the importance of the fruit you choose for seeds. Make sure the seeds are from plants that are heirloom or open-pollinated kinds. These are plants in their original forms. Their seeds will produce plants with the same qualities as their parents. Hybridized plants usually produce the vegetables sold in big food stores. They are created by breeding two or more different kinds of plants to capture the best qualities of each. Attempting to grow seeds from hybrids will not lead to happy harvesting, however. The resulting plants will not have the expected qualities, but instead carry the genes of just one of its parents. And it is impossible to identify which parent that will be. For this reason, it is best not to grow seeds from store-bought food.
Many plants become cross-pollinated in the garden. Pollinators, other insects, animals, and wind spread pollen from one plant to another. To ensure the seeds you collect will grow into plants that match their parents, give them space. Place different kinds of the same crop as far apart as possible when planting a home garden. To avoid cross-pollination surprises, plant only one kind of each vegetable from which to harvest seeds. If you want to save tomato seeds, for example, grow only one kind of tomato in your garden. If that feels too limiting, go ahead and experiment. Choose heirloom plants so the risks from cross-pollination are reduced. The plants will be fine, even if they are not what you expected. Store seeds in a cool, dry place in a covered glass jar or paper envelope away from ripening fruit. The temporary addition of a drying element to the jar will remove any remaining wetness. But remove it after a few days to avoid over-drying. Here is how to collect and save seeds from some common homegrown crops.
At the end of the growing season, lettuce plants will grow a flower that will develop seed heads. The process is called bolting. and the seed heads are called a puff. When the puff is dry, remove the stem. Put the puff in a paper bag, close the bag, and shake. The seeds will come off the flower and fall to the bottom of the bag.
Basil seeds are tiny, so separating them from the small flower is a slow and careful process. When plants bolt at the end of the season, permit flowers to remain until they fade completely. Clip them off and place them in a sieve. Then use your fingers to push them against the bottom of the sieve.
Beet and carrot plants produce seeds only in their second year, after a period of cold storage. In areas with cold winters, simply leave plants in the ground over winter. In warm climates, you have to create winter indoors. At the end of the first season, cut the plants down to 5 centimeters. Carefully dig up roots and store them in a refrigerator or other cool place. Replant them outdoors the following spring. When the leaves of second-year beet plants turn brown, remove the seed stock from the top of the plant and place it in a paper bag. Store in a cool, dry place for at least 2 weeks. Then, give the bag a good shake to separate the seeds. Pour them onto a plate and blow on them to separate the chaff. Let second-year carrot flowers dry on the plant. Cut them off and dry them further in a paper bag for a week or two. Then, treat them in the same way as beets.
Choose the best-looking pepper from your healthiest plant and let it remain on the plant until it is overripe and wrinkled. Slice it in half and remove the seeds. Throw away any that are discolored or otherwise undesirable. Spread seeds in a single level on thick paper and let them dry in a warm place. Do not put them in direct sunlight. Shake the seeds around from time to time to ensure even drying. The process should take about a week.
Permit an eggplant to overripen on the plant until it becomes hard and wrinkled and loses its shine and color. Cut it open, remove its seeds, and place them in a bowl of water. Stir the water to wash off anything that might be sticking to them. Then use a cloth to dry the seeds gently. Leave the seeds on a piece of cloth, shaking them a little every day until completely dry. This can take several weeks.
Green beans can produce a lot during the season. To get seeds, leave developing pods on one plant until they are completely dried and brown. Next, cut the pods off the plant and place them in a cool, dark spot to dry further. Later, remove the seeds and spread them on cloth. Let them harden there for a few days. I'm Dorothy Gundy.
And I'm Katie Weaver.
Thank you.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Today on The Making of a Nation, we tell about slavery and how it affected the history of the United States. Here is Steve Ember.
Slavery is the custom of one person controlling or owning another. Some historians say it began following the development of farming about 10,000 years ago. People forced prisoners of war to work for them. Other slaves were criminals or people who could not repay money they owed. It is said the first known slaves lived more than 5,000 years ago in the Sumerian society of what is now Iraq. Slavery also existed among people in China, India, Africa, the Middle East, and the Americas. It expanded as trade and industry increased. This increase created a demand for a labor force to produce goods for export. Slaves did most of the work. Most ancient people thought of slavery as a natural condition that could happen to anyone at any time. Few saw it as evil or unfair. In most cities, slaves could be freed by their owners and become citizens. In later times, slaves provided the labor needed to produce products that were in demand. Sugar was one of these products. Italians established large sugar farms beginning around the 12th century. They used slaves from Russia and other parts of Europe to do the work. By the year 1300, African blacks had begun to replace the Russian slaves. They were bought or captured from North African Arabs, who used them as slaves for years. By the 1500s, Spain and Portugal had American colonies. The Europeans forced native Indians to work in large farms and mines in the colonies. Most of the Indians died from European diseases and poor treatment. So the Spanish and Portuguese began to bring in people from West Africa as slaves. France, Britain, and the Netherlands did the same in their American colonies. England's southern colonies in North America developed a farm economy that could not survive without slave labor. Many slaves lived on large farms called plantations. These plantations produced important crops traded by the colony, crops such as cotton and tobacco. Each plantation was like a small village owned by one family. That family lived in a large house, usually facing a river. Many separate buildings were needed on a plantation. For example, a building was needed for cooking. and buildings were needed for workers to produce goods such as furniture that were used on the plantation. The business of the plantation was farming, so there also were barns for animals and buildings for storing and drying crops. There was a house to smoke meat so it could be kept safely, and there was a place on the river from which goods were sent by ship to England. The plantation owner controlled the farm and saw that it earned money. He supervised, fed, and clothed the people living on the property, including the slaves. Larger plantations might have 200 slaves. They worked in the fields on crops that would be sold or eaten by the people who lived on the plantation. They also raised animals for meat and milk. Field slaves worked very long and hard. They worked each day from the time the sun rose until it set. Many of these slaves lived in extreme poverty, in small houses with no heat or furniture. Sometimes 5 or 10 people lived together in one room. House slaves usually lived in the home of the plantation owner. They did the cooking and cleaning in the house. House slaves worked fewer hours than field slaves, but were more closely supervised by the owner and his family. Laws approved in the southern colonies made it illegal for slaves to marry, own property, or earn their freedom. These laws also barred slaves from receiving an education or even learning to read. But some owners permitted their slaves to earn their freedom or gave them money for good work. Other owners punished slaves to get them to work. The punishments included beatings, withholding food, and threatening to sell members of a slave's family. Some plantation owners executed slaves suspected of serious crimes by hanging them or burning them alive. Historians say that people who were rich enough to own many slaves became leaders in their local areas. They were members of the local governments. They attended meetings of the legislatures in the capitals of their colonies, usually 2 times a year. Slave owners had the time and the education to greatly influence political life in the southern colonies, because the hard work on their farms was done by slaves. Today, most people in the world condemn slavery. That was not true in the early years of the American nation. Many Americans thought slavery was evil, but necessary. Yet, owning slaves was common among the richer people in the early 1700s. Many of the leaders in the colonies who fought for American independence owned slaves. This was true in the northern colonies as well as the southern ones. One example is the famous American diplomat, inventor, and businessman Benjamin Franklin. He owned slaves for 30 years and sold them at his general store. But his ideas about slavery changed during his long life. Benjamin Franklin started the first schools to teach blacks and later argued for their freedom. Slavery did not become a force in the northern colonies, mainly because of economic reasons. Cold weather and poor soil could not support such a farm economy as was found in the South. As a result, the North came to depend on manufacturing and trade. Trade was the way colonists got the English goods they needed. It was also the way to earn money by selling products found in the New World. New England became a center for such trade across the seas. The people who lived there became shipbuilders so they could send the products to England. They used local wood to build the ships. They also sold wood and wood products. They became businessmen carrying goods around the world. The New England shipbuilding towns near the Atlantic Ocean grew quickly as a result. The largest of these towns was Boston, Massachusetts. By 1720, it had more than 10,000 people. Only two towns in England were larger, London and Bristol. More than 25% of the men in Boston had invested in shipping or worked in it. Ship captains and businessmen held most of the public offices. The American colonies traded goods such as whale oil, ginger, iron, wood, and rum, an alcoholic drink made from sugar cane. Ships carried these goods from the New England colonies to Africa. There they were traded for black Africans who became slaves in the American colonies. The Africans had been captured by enemy tribesmen and sold to African slave traders. The New England ship captains would buy as many as they could put on their ships. Conditions on these ships were cruel. The Africans were crowded together and forced to travel in areas so small they could hardly move. Some were kept in chains. Many killed themselves rather than live under such conditions. Others died of health disorders they caught on the ship. Yet many did survive the trip and became slaves in the southern colonies or in the Caribbean islands. Black slaves were needed to work on Caribbean sugar plantations. The southern American colonies needed them to work on the tobacco and rice plantations. By 1750, almost 25% of the total number of people in the American colonies were black slaves. From the 1500s to the 1800s, Europeans sent about 12 million black slaves from Africa to America. Almost 2 million people died on those slave ships. Historians say English ships carried the greatest number of Africans into slavery. One slave ship captain came to hate what he was doing and turned to religion. His name was John Newton. He stopped taking part in the slave trade and became a leader in the Anglican Church. He is famous for having written the song Amazing Grace.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.